We documented everything. Can I do it, Dad? Like, wanting to film and shit, you know? And they would never let me. They're like, no. And then my dad was in the Navy, so he would go on cruises for like 6 or 8 months at a time. This is a day before he went on cruise for 8 months. This is the first time he let me film because, I don't know, I guess he trusted me more than my mom to film, so. Right here.
I take camera movies.
No,
this needs to be adjusted.
I take camera movies, and then look at this shit. He starts critiquing my filming right away.
Now you gotta talk, tell what's going on.
Telling me how to narrate and shit. Listen how harsh this is right here.
This is boring.
Hmm?
This is boring.
Well, what do you think it's like when you're skateboarding? It's just boring.
I do better.
It's dull and boring and no fun. We take pictures anyway, just to make you feel good.
Just to make you feel good. I don't know, he sounds like a dick there, huh? Kinda. But he wasn't a dick, like. My dad was definitely cool, supportive of the skating and everything, and my mom too. Like, you know, there was no such thing as a skateboarding career or a video career, but they definitely supported me in it, and because of them, I was able to, like, do it a lot more and flourish, you know? This is the first time I watched professionals skate. Watching them skate in person blew my mind, and especially Tony Hawk. Tony Hawk was my idol, so.
Is that what you wanted?
He is one yes. Child.
Oh my gosh.
At that age, you either liked Christian Hosoi or Tony Hawk, and I was for sure 100% into Tony Hawk, which is nerdy, which I don't know, I guess kind of matches me. I grew up in landlocked little city, Lemoore, California. One day I was at a pool party and Future Primitive just came out. And I just remember like watching it like, oh man, this is so awesome. And like nothing ever hit me that hard before.
Here we are, the morning before we go to McGill's on our last day here.
Tell you always some tape.
Like look at this, filming propaganda at McGill's. Like this is one of the first times, you know? Or no, maybe it was Badness, 89. Yeah, but that's at McGill's, you know? That's like seeing professional skateboarders for the first time. There's Tony Hawk and Danny Way. And the crazy thing is they're there to film Mike McGill. They're not even filming Tony Hawk and Danny Way. And then only 2 years later, I had to move to Japan. And then I kind of entered my own world of being disconnected from the skate world.
Look at their cameras, they're sick compared to mine. I mean, I'm kidding.
I was over there for 7 years. And so in the early 90s, when all the wheels were small and people were in baggy pants, I would come visit and see it here and there, but I never got to be a part of that. When I moved back from Japan, I'd only been back for like a month or two, and my buddy Timo from high school, he's like, what are you up to, Grant? What have you been doing? Dude, we're doing this thing called Disgusted TV. It's a surf, skate, snow channel on cable TV. You should come check it out. Like, he knew I always filmed and stuff, and he's like, you should come see what it's all about. Disgusted TV turned into Progression Video Magazine, and eventually I was able to get $1,000 a month, and right when I got that first paycheck, that $1,000 a month, I quit Trader Joe's. I had one semester of school left, and I was sick of driving down to San Marcos. I didn't like any of my teachers. I wasn't learning anything. The video class sucked. And so I quit school within a semester of graduating, and I just worked full-time at Progression. And that's when I went full force into it. Like, do or die. This is everything right here. As I'm working at progression, I started working on more parts, and I started working really close with Adam Alfaro. That caught the eye of John Lucero, who was sponsoring Adam at the time. Black Label was sponsoring Adam. And Jim Gagne came out filming with us, and eventually Salman Aga came out filming with us. And I guess I passed whatever, you know, test to be their filmer. And so Salman went back to Lucero and was like, yeah, let's get this guy on as a filmer. I couldn't believe it. Like, that was like a dream come true. Definitely the, you know, highest moment of my life right there.
Hey, let us get 5 minutes. It's my birthday, dude. We're trying to shoot an article for a magazine. It's gonna be really sweet.
No problem.
He just gave you 10, right?
Yeah, but I usually get 20.
My favorite thing ever in skate filming was follow filming. Just follow filming through bowls, lines, whatever it was. And Chet, he was the funnest to do this with. And it all started this one day. We went to the Vagabond pool in Fresno. We were just skating the Vagabond, Chet was killing it. And then he's like, dude, what if you like follow me through the bowl? I was like, sure, man, yeah. And so this is like the first time we ever did it right here.
I got that one. Yeah.
So then we worked on Back in Black, and things started to change a little bit. Ragdoll went to Pigwood. Melcher wasn't on anymore. And the team that I kind of worked with there changed, you know, like after Back in Black, John had to let me go. I don't think they had the money to keep a full-time staff filmer on anymore. But he was so cool, man. He gave me 6 months notice. Like, what boss gives you 6 months notice, you know? Chet had my back more than anybody has ever had my back, any skater or anybody. If you watch like a lot of the Nike Chronicles videos, he's wearing a Shark Attack shirt, and that was my nickname, was Shark Attack. That's the nickname he gave me. That's the nickname everybody on Black Label called me. He just supported me so much, you know? So I love him forever for that.
And I wanna say, summer of the fucking year, Shark Attack, bitch! Yeah!
But through Chet, you know, I got to work with Independent Trucks, which was another huge moment for me. They were doing a Northwest tour and they wanted to film it and they wanted to put out a video, which was a huge honor because it was the first video that Independent Trucks ever put out. So when Chet was helping me get all those jobs, we went on one trip. We were gonna go across the US in his Volvo. We got halfway through the country in Texas and we went to go skate this full pipe. And you had to take a raft to get across the water with all our gear. We had a lot of cleaning up we had to do, so we had shovels, we had Bondo, all that stuff. I'm skating, just taking runs. I set the camera up on a tripod, and I'm skating, and then a freak accident happened. I was turning frontside, coming down, about to go backside, and when I was in the flats, my board just power slid 90 degrees, and I slammed into the face wall super hard. And I turned over and looked at my knee, and my kneecap was just smashed to shit. And like in that moment, I was looking at my knee and I was just like I saw my whole life just like end right there. Like, no more skating, probably no more filming. Like, I'm gonna have to film some dumb shit now, no more skate filming. And I couldn't skate or do anything for probably like over a year, you know? During that recovery time, Josh Beagle hit me up to film the foundation video, Cataclysmic Abyss. And I'm like, well, I'm in a leg brace, man, but you know, I'm not gonna say no to some opportunity like that. So I went to Europe with this leg brace and I just couldn't film lines. But even then, like, we still found a way. Like, I have some funny footage of Ethan just pushing me as I buttboard and filming a line. It's pretty funny.
Yes!
So after foundation, web videos started picking up, YouTube started picking up, content started, like skate videos started to be more distributed on the web. And then I got a phone call from Rhino saying Lee DuPont was looking for a filmer to work at Circa. They had a specific demand of 2 web videos a week. When you only have so few guys living around you in California and you have to put up 2 videos a week, you exhaust a lot of your ideas pretty quick. More and more, it started to wear on me. And then King of the Road happened in 2010, I think. And I went on the King of the Road trip, and that was kind of just the last straw for me. Like, I was drinking the most I ever drank in my life. I remember the last day coming home, and for like the hair challenge, my head was half shaved, and I just had like a life hangover, you know? I was just like exhausted and burnt, and I almost tried to get fired by not doing my job well, and I did get fired. After that, it was just like questioning everything, and so I made the choice to just quit drinking and, you know, try to get my life back together. I decided my goal in life from that point was to get that stoke that you get when you're 14, 15, 16, that stoke of learning a trick, landing it your first time, that immense joy you get. Slowly but surely, man, I started getting happier and like started skating, and skateboarding was the key. Skateboarding made me happy again after being so burnt out on it. And after a year of being sober and skating, Shad Lambert hit me up for a job at Supra. And I was ready. I was like, I had a new vigor, just ready to do this, you know? And so started working at Supra and filmed all their commercials and, you know, dialogue based stuff, interviews and things like that, telling stories. You know, I filmed a lot of bowls and pools and ditches, and, you know, the people that watched the videos I made, it didn't really matter if it was filmed so amazingly well. And I saw Supra as a time where I could like do more commercial stuff and make stuff that's clean. Working with Muska, working with Eric Ellington, Tom Penny, like all these dudes, these legendary dudes, to be able to work closely with them, it was such an amazing experience, you know? And I learned probably the most that I've ever learned at Supra. One thing out of everything though, the one thing that I still want to hold close to me and keep close is just the act of skateboarding itself. You know, I got burnt out on it before, and I found a new way to be involved in skateboarding and still film, but keep the act of skateboarding a little bit separate. And so I'll never get burnt out on that again. I keep that for myself, and I never want to lose that feeling of being a 17-year-old ever again. I want to have that until the day I die. So now I just look forward to, you know, editing more documentary style stuff, still being involved in skateboarding as much as possible, but just not jumping fences at 2 a.m, you know? And I got my mini ramp in the back, so I can edit right here. And whenever I need a break, I can just go out there and skate. And, you know, it's my perfect little paradise right here.